Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? Over in the southeastern part of the sky, the largest planet in our solar system, Jupiter, is just past opposition. It reached opposition on July 14th at 0800 hours, and it is currently at magnitude negative 2.8. So it's the brightest object in the sky after the Sun, Moon, and Venus. And Venus is actually rising in the morning sky. So in the evening sky, Jupiter is the thing. It is not far away from Saturn, and we will see how those two will get closer over the rest of this year. But for now, Jupiter kind of stands alone. And when to see it, to me, is really when it's at least 15 degrees above the horizon is kind of an ideal time. So even at like 10 o'clock at night, I would be able to see it as it is 15 degrees up at that point for me. And then around midnight or so, it's and a little past then, it's going to be nice and high as it crosses over the meridian. And that's really the best time, of course, to observe it. But you can observe it either before then or after then, too. You'll just get the best views if you're looking at it through the least amount of atmosphere. Plus, a couple other tips for you on being able to see it well. If you are able to, try to aim your telescope or binoculars across a grassy field or even some water, if possible, because less heat rising in front of your telescope creates less disturbance, and it means that you will have a steadier view, potentially, to be able to see the planet at higher magnification. That's not always possible, because sometimes the jet stream just does stuff that does not work out for you. But those are going to be the best ways for you to at least take away some of the gremlins that could potentially get in the way of a better view for you. So how can we see this awesome planet? Well, first of all, we can zoom in just a little bit. But there's four moons of Jupiter that are visible. And those are all visible even in binoculars. Now, it's better if you're able to steady the binocular somehow on a tripod or some other means, but they are visible because they're all about fifth or sixth magnitude. So they're actually fairly bright objects in and of themselves. If they were not right around Jupiter being so darn bright, then you could see them almost naked eye if you were under dark enough skies. But because they're so close to Jupiter, we need binoculars to be able to see that. But the better way to view it is in telescope, where we get a little bit more view and it's a little bit brighter, and it's also we get some more detail out of it. Now I like to zoom in way like this because that looks awesome. If I back up just a little bit in time, we can also see how the great red spot is there. That particular storm has been raging for well over 300 years. It's about three Earths wide, so it's a rather enormous storm as far as storms go, especially compared to hurricanes here. And you can see that there's some other features that are pretty well known, like the north and south equatorial bands that are going to be these orange brownish sections along here. And you might also see some of the other storms if you're able to get some good magnification on it, or some of the festoons and whirls and things like that that happen in the atmosphere as this planet rotates. And it rotates very quickly. It only takes 10 hours to make one complete rotation. Actually, a little less than that. It's about 5 minutes less than that. So view stellarium to see where the great red spot is going to be, because as you can see, it rotates out of view in just a couple of hours time. So from 9 o'clock through, you know, 2 o'clock there, it goes all the way across the front. So if you're able to, try and time when you're going to be able to see it so you get a good view at that particular storm. Now, what some people will say is that one of the better magnifications to use, I'm going to back this off with no Barlow lens, is around 200 times on this particular one. I've got quite a bit more than that. I've got about 400 times just so we can kind of see what's happening so it doesn't look too small in stellarium. But 150 to 250 times magnification is probably going to be about it. And the reason why is because, one, the atmosphere, also that air in front of you, but also Jupiter tends to get a little soft sometimes, and so we have to wait and be patient for those moments when the planet steadies and becomes clear, and then kind of make a mental image of some of those details that we see, and so that the next time in a minute or two or three or five that we get another few seconds of steadiness, then we just keep adding to that, so our mental image is what we're able to provide to remember how good those details are on the surface of that particular planet. Not really the surface, it's really just the tops of the clouds, right? But those are some of the objects that we can see and how to see some of them. What I also want to point out is that there are some really interesting events that happen because of how those moons go around Jupiter. So if you notice over time, those moons change position quite a bit. Well, one thing that happens on the 15th, now it's the 15th universal time, so for here in the United States, that's going to be on the 14th, but see that little black dot? Let me zoom in on that for you so we have a little bit more. See those? We have a double moon transit happening on that particular night. So if you are looking from 10:30 or so, that's central time. So Eastern time is going to be 11:30 on the 14th. You can have about an hour and a half's worth of not only those moon transits, because you've got Io and Ganymede that are creating those shadows. Io is right here on the across the face of the planet, and then Ganymede's right over here. We've also got the red spot right there in the center of the planet. So this, if you are going to be trying to take some photos of Jupiter, this would be a great time to do that. So you've got a full month to practice from now until then to get this really cool image, assuming that it's clear for you that night. This also happens again about a week later. Check this out. On the 22nd, now this is the 22nd, also universal time, but for some of us, this is actually going to occur after it is actually midnight. So watch what happens when I kind of go forward in time. Whoops, I got to bring it back. Watch what happens when we go forward in time. There we go. There's a moon again. And then we get a second one. So Io again is the first one. And then Ganymede follows and is the larger one. And the red spot is not quite in the center this time. Also, this gets to be pretty late at night. Eastern time, you're going to be at 2:30 in the morning to get that. I'd be at 1:30 in the morning. So I'm not sure we'd really get a good opportunity for you. My apologies for you over in Western Europe. You may not have a chance in India. My bad. You won't be able to see this just because it's going to be the wrong timing for you because it'll be during the day. But there will be other ones, and I will try to highlight those when they do come up. That's some of the interesting things that we can see on the amazing Jupiter. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.